Hi, it's Melanie McLean. This is a session for CSRE. We're going to talk about apples and oranges. You've heard me say before, you can't compare an apple to an orange. That's really true in real estate when we're talking about pricing and people's attitudes. So I'm going to talk a little bit about both sellers and buyers. And first I'm going to do the seller's seven deadly sins. The first one is pricing higher than their competition. They're an apple. All of the homes which compete with them are apples, but they think they have an orange. They don't have an orange, they just have an apple. Might be a really nice apple, might be really shiny, but it's still an apple. Refusing reasonable offers early on. This is one of the things so many people do, and it's the optimistic attitude, my goodness, if somebody will pay me this the first day, how much more would I get in the future? It doesn't work that way. Buyers who are definitely committed to finding a home are paying such attention to the market that when a new listing comes on the market, it's like this nice, gorgeous red apple. And it's fresh and they're very interested in it. If this apple sits around on my desk for a couple months, it's going to turn soft, it's probably going to rot, and it's not going to be attractive to anyone. The sellers need to understand the buyers are looking and the reasonable one is going to come early on. The third deadly sin is not putting the property in the best possible condition for sale. We've all heard the same thing. We live in our house. And most of us are polite enough that we don't say out loud, how can you live in this house? It's a mess. But our sellers have to be focused on getting that home in the best possible condition. If they have young children, I know that can be a real chore. I've got young grandchildren. I know how quickly they can mess up a room or a house. But you want to get it in shape, get it sold, and then you can relax. Because guess what? Appraisers and home inspectors do not care that there's clutter in a house. That's not going to affect what we do. Now, making showing the property difficult. I've had many sellers, so have you. We'd like 24 hours notice, or worse yet, we'd like 48 hours notice. Those of us who sell real estate know we don't always get notice, and therefore it's very hard for us to give them notice. It comes down to this. If you've got a buyer who suddenly has an afternoon open up and they're ready to go look at houses, chances are they're not going to buy the house they can't see, even if there's a virtual tour available. Chances are they're going to buy one they can see. So you need to make showing the home easy. Not recognizing that a home to you is a house or a commodity to a buyer. We all have memories associated with our homes. Things that happened there. We brought our first babies home from the hospital to this house. We planted a tree. We've created a garden. So it's home. We have those memories of Thanksgiving dinners. So that's special to us. But to a buyer, it's just one of many they're going to look at. For a buyer, a house becomes a home when they move in, begin to personalize it, and begin to make memories there. There's two more seven deadly seller sins. One is blaming the agent for the market. Sellers need to understand, good heavens, if we could fix the market, we would. There's no one listening to my presentation here that wouldn't love to be able to wave a magic wand and make the market better, but we can't. The market is what it is. And then not reducing the price in a timely manner, causing market aging. With the widespread use of instantaneous communication via the internet, if you've got a listing that's been on the market even only a week or two with no activity, you need to revisit the price. Unless you're in an area with such high supply and low demand that very few things are being shown, and then that still circles us back to price. Because if we want to sell, when we're in a market saturated with listings, we're going to have to bring the price down. Now, it's not just sellers who make mistakes. So let's talk about what buyers do. First one is thinking they're the only buyer out there. This is pretty naive. And there are buyers who, even if they're told it might be a multiple offer situation, refuse to believe that could be happening. They're not the only buyer out there. The second one is one I get a lot. Oh, every seller plugs in X percent over what they really want to get to give themselves room to negotiate. Or my Uncle Harry said every house is 10% overpriced. That's not true. Some homes are priced to sell at full price. Some homes sell for more than full price. So believing that there's automatically a built-in cushion for you to make an offer could mean that you don't get the house. Not believing the agent when we advise you to go to at least full price. In some markets, buyers who succeeded in getting houses wrote contracts above list price. There was that much competition. So you need a buyer's agent if you're a buyer, and you need a buyer's agent who understands the market and can say to you, look, in the position you're in, we're going to have to do X, Y, and Z to get you a house. Loading up the contract with contingencies is another issue. Now, first of all, on one level, every contingency you put in a contract, every piece of personal property you asked for, which was not included, is a reason the seller has to say no. On the other hand, you do have to have contingencies to protect yourself. Most of us need financing, so we need a mortgage contingency. A home inspection contingency is often very prudent. Now, I say often, there could be circumstances where you would decide as a buyer, you've viewed the property, you have a certain level of expertise, you're comfortable with what you've seen, and you're willing to go forward. You have to listen to your agent's advice about that. But understand, when people start doing things like, and this is one of my favorites, well, I have to sell my house in order to buy. And that may or may not be true. Often it's, I would really feel much more comfortable if my house was sold before I bought your house. And I understand that. But from the seller's point of view, that's your problem, not their problem. You have just given them another reason to say no. And I guarantee you, if there are two offers on the table at the same time, and one person does not need to sell a house to buy this house, and the other person does, unless there's a whole bunch of other things going on in that contract, the person who doesn't have to sell to buy will probably get it. You want to have solid financing. You don't want to ask for personal property they didn't include. So you don't want to overload that contract with contingencies. Now, both buyers and sellers need to be realistic. They need to compare apples to apples, not to oranges. Apples and oranges together gives us fruit salad. We don't want fruit salad. You can't compare what you're doing in your market with what your cousin did 500 miles away, or what your parents did when they bought their last house, or what your best friend did when she bought a house 3 years ago. You have to compare apples to apples, and you have to learn within your market. And as we all know as agents, each party may learn with some pain. There's an expression we use in real estate. Some people have to lose a house before they get a house. And what we mean is they have to be convinced of the reality that no, there's not a 10% room to negotiate in this listing price. They're asking that price because they want that price. And you know what? They got that price. And for the sellers, we've all had the seller who we presented an offer to them. We said, this is a great offer. You should really either take it or counter closely to it. And no, I'm going to hold out. It'll be better. And then 2 weeks later, that seller is back at us saying, so whatever happened to those buyers who made that offer? And most of the time, the answer is, oh, they bought another house. Ouch. So anyhow, thanks. Fun to spend some more time with you. And talk to you again soon, I hope.